To anaesthesia inductions, a few important patterns that will make any induction easy. The aim of this is really that there's, you know, really a select few critical general anaesthetic inductions, and I want to give you something that's pretty practical and effective, with also specific doses to think about. And I think when I was going through my training, you know, everyone gets a bit of propofol, an opioid, and a relaxant, and then every other induction seems to be something that resembles a cardiac induction. But I guess I want to make mention that each of your cardiovascularly relevant inductions will probably be something like a critical cardiac issue, a hypovolaemic shock, pulmonary hypertension, subarach, or anything kind of cardiac lesion like a valve. And each of these have very different priorities, and they can be subtly different. These can be easy enough to talk about individually, but let's say you get a situation where a patient has a couple of these different pathologies. I think it's really useful to have this framework, because then you can talk about your ideal priorities and combine methods for these inductions to talk about your case in a knowledgeable way. Let's imagine a patient who's like a 60 kilo, 70 year old gentleman, who's got an ejection fraction of 20%, so, you know, pretty bad, due to some kind of ischemic cardiomyopathy. What, broadly speaking, are your goals? And then just off the cuff, just tell me what your induction doses would be and any extra monitoring you'd have above an outline.
For this patient, my main goals would be hemodynamic and basis. So I want to ensure that they have adequate preload prior to induction, they're in sinus rhythm with a normal control rate, and that their contractility and afterload are maintained during my induction. So to facilitate that, I would induce them for a general anaesthetic utilizing a dose of propofol of about 1 milligram per kilo.
Yeah, so lights, actually, if I gave you the dose, the weight of the patient, I'll give you the weights for every one of these. 60 kilo patient.
Yep. Okay. I'd utilize a dose of propofol of 50 milligrams. I'd utilize fentanyl with a dose of 350 micrograms. And the relaxant that I'd choose would be rocuronium. And I would give a dose of 0.6 milligrams per kilo. So in this patient, for this anaesthetic, I get 50 milligrams.
Fantastic. That's a very common cardiac induction. If you haven't, a lot of you will already have done cardiac, and, you know, it really is running a very small dose of propofol, giving a big dose of fentanyl, you know, turn up the volatile, and they often have a lot of Midaz on board from the lines you put in as well, and then you slowly get the volatile up and put the tube in at your leisure. But yeah, again, when you've told me your goals, the detail doesn't matter so much. So hypovolemic shock, I used to think this was very similar, but I want to make note that this is a very different induction. Say this patient is a 20-year-old motor vehicle accident, so some kind of intra-abdominal laceration of a vessel. Let's say they've dropped 3 liters, and you rush them up to theater, and you're, you know, they're tachycardic, hypotensive at maybe 70 millimeters mercury. So you're running your little hypotensive resuscitation type plan, and you want to induce before a laparotomy. So otherwise fit and well, no allergies, 70 kilo, 20-year-old. What do you want? What are your goals, and what are the actual drugs you give?
I would make all reasonable attempts to ensure to adequately resuscitate this patient to achieve a blood pressure that's to maintain adequate organ perfusion. So a BP of 90 systolic would be preferable. And my goals in this patient would be to maintain sympathetic tone. And to avoid any, and to minimize drugs that would reduce contractility and afterload, essentially. And to this end, I would choose an induction with ketamine, 1 milligram per kilo IV, and rocuronium, 1 milligram per kilo.
Fantastic. I'll do something very similar. Just to know that when I was doing through my training, to me, this was seemed to be very similar to the cardiac induction, as in I saw a lot of people just approaching it very similarly, but just note that I really don't care about contractility. It's a young person often, they have no problems with contractility, and I don't care about a rapid heart rate. I want as much sympathetic tone in these patients as is reasonable. So, you know, just maintaining lots of volume and having aramine running is probably the biggest deal for me. So yeah, RSI, ketamine, midaz, sucks with metaraminol to maintain vasomotor tone is what I'd do. And again, just to reiterate, obviously, I haven't given doses in this situation. Every examiner I've ever spoken to, they'll give you the scenario of a patient make whatever assumptions about their weight, and just give some reasonable doses, you know, round it off. Because, you know, in real life, you never say I'd give 88 milligrams of something. You round off to 100 or 50, and if it's relevant, just round off to whatever number, but give a number. Next case, pulmonary hypertension. So imagine this patient is a, let's say, a 60-year-old female, 60 kilos, with some kind of lung pathology, which has caused pulmonary hypertension with RSVP pressures of, say, above 90. So pretty serious.
The main goals in a pulmonary hypertension induction is to avoid large changes in pulmonary arterial pressure. So avoiding acidosis and hypercapnia and hypoxia. So therefore, I'll perform a technique that allows rapid facilitation of those parameters. And essentially, I perform a standard technique but ensure the airway doesn't become obstructed.
Yeah, sounds good. And you're very right to assume that the right heart is doing well. So again, my goals, I think of two things. I think of, you know, right heart function and your afterload, which is your pulmonary vascular function. And I'd do something very similar. Avoid increasing pulmonary artery pressure with those things you mentioned. I'd also maybe just make an attempt to make sure my ventilation pressures are low, and then maintain right heart perfusion. And often this is, if the right heart is bad, this is like a critical cardiac for the right heart plus my pulmonary artery pressures. That's great. And again, this would look very similar to the critical cardiac induction in many cases if the right heart is bad. Otherwise, exactly what you said. Let's go through a subarach bleed case. So imagine someone is like our previous patient, say, 60-year-old female, grade 3 subarach, 60 kilos, and you're going to do an induction in theater for clipping.
So my goal would be to avoid any extremes of blood pressure to maintain cerebral perfusion and to perform neuroprotective anaesthesia. Mm-hmm. So I would use propofol and remi, Teva, 1 milligram per kilo of rock, I think.
Yeah, sounds good. So again, I like that you mentioned hypertension. So I specifically mentioned rebleed because rebleed is the highest mortality event in this patient, having, you know, 50 or 70% if the patient does rebleed. And that can be, you know, related back to having a hypertensive episode causing that increase in your transmural pressure gradient on induction. So everything I do is to avoid that primarily, and then secondarily cerebral perfusion. And again, you can do, you've said your goals, you can do whatever you want, really. Propofol, remi, fentanyl, Teva. Because I'm less experienced with titrating the remi to that effect, I just give bigger doses of alfentanil plus propofol in a decent dose plus sux. And then I just add something else on about, you know, IV lignocaine or esmolol if there's a hypertensive episode. But again, stating your goals, the detail matters a lot less. Table in your workbooks. When I first did this as a trainee, I thought it was just really useful. Like, you know, every single valve lesion plus HOCM and tamponade has certain priorities, and it's great to see people talking in terms of preload, rate, rhythm, contractility, and afterload. I remember back in the day, one of my consultants said this is the way I talk about, you know, cardiac function, and I just found it really useful. So it's really great to hear that people are using that way because it just communicates a lot to me personally.
Priorities that I was, you know, told as I was going through my training, and probably be similar to what a lot of you have gone through. So aortic stenosis, you know, slow sinus squeeze is what people talked about. So full preload, low normal rate, sinus rhythm is critical. Contractility is something to maintain, and afterload high to maintain coronary perfusion pressure. And then the other ones I filled out in this way. So
aortic regurg and mitral regurg, full, fast, forward. So full preload, fast rate, sinus rhythm isn't particularly critical, maintain contractility and low afterload. These parameters all support forward flow. Mitral stenosis, a bit interesting. So unlike aortic stenosis where you have a full preload, most of the case we have of mitral stenosis, if we have too much of an autotransfusion, such as in the pregnancy cases, they can go into APO. So I think, you know, trying to achieve that normal preload level is obviously challenging, but an ideal. Low normal rate again, sinus rhythm would be ideal, maintaining contractility and again a higher afterload. HOCM is very similar to aortic stenosis, however, you know, having a low contractility decreases that dynamic obstruction that can happen when you have this really thick musculature and hypertrophy of the left ventricular outflow tract. So full preload, low normal heart rate to maintain your diastolic perfusion time. Sinus rhythm is ideal, low contractility and a high afterload to maintain that perfusion of your thick myocardium. With tamponade, I think of adrenaline. So anything that adrenaline does essentially is what I want for tamponade. So full preload, fast rate is what often occurs and is supportive of a cardiac output. Sinus rhythm would be ideal, high contractility is maintained, and afterload is high again because you've got such a high intraventricular pressure, you really need to maintain the coronary perfusion through that as well. So in summary from that, we've got the critical cardiac, hypovolemic shock, pulmonary hypertension, subarachnoid bleed, and valves. And these are just a sample of some of the common cardiovascularly relevant anesthesia inductions that you'll get. And I found it really useful to have the priorities very specifically outlined for each of these. That allows me to tailor my drugs towards those priorities. But also, if I get a really complex situation, which is unlikely but can happen in the viva, if I do get something that combines a critical cardiac patient also having hypovolemic shock, at least I know how to kind of talk through or talk around the complexities of the potentially conflicting goals.